Go.
So today we're going to be talking about preparation for going up on the mountain. And as I've mentioned to many of you before, this idea of going up on the mountain begins with the severance phase, where we're beginning to examine our lives and what we're putting down, what we no longer wish to carry with us to the mountain. So it's also about three ceremonies of preparation. They say when you go up on the mountain, or really any ritual, you're not going there for yourself. You're going up there for your community, your families, your loved ones. So this idea of going up on the mountain for your people, and in preparation for that, there's the making of prayer ties. So the making of prayer ties is about gathering prayer bundles that you make, and I'll show you in just a moment. And at some point, as you get closer to the quest, also going out to your community, those that are supporting you or know that you're doing this, and soliciting prayers from them that you also make and you put into your bundles. So this idea that when you go up on the mountain, you're not simply carrying your own prayers, but you're carrying the prayers of your people. So the making of prayer ties is that you would get like a couple of yards, maybe to start with, of red cotton cloth, like this. And you tear it into about 2 to 3 inch strips, and then cut those strips into 2 to 3 inch squares. And they say, in terms of how many you should make, I heard it once said that if you made 400 or 1,000, it wouldn't be too many. So there's not too many prayers that you can make. So in the making of a prayer bundle, and using the word prayer may have a limited scope of meaning for some people. So you can also use the word gratitude, to put your gratitudes in, and to formulate gratitudes as a prayer means not simply gratitudes for things that already exist in your life, but gratitude for that which you're manifesting as if it did already exist. So you speak it in present tense. So in making a prayer, you take a little dried tobacco, which I have here in my fingers, and I place it into the center of the cloth, and I bundle up the corners. And speaking now to my training group who will be questing here in a few months, I will make this prayer for you, and it will sit on my altar, and I'll bring it to quest. And that is, thank you, Creator, for these ones that are going up on the mountain to remember those agreements they made with their ancestors about the gifts of medicine they were bringing into this world to offer their people, their loved ones, their community. And may they remember these gifts and the beauty that they each carry within themselves as they go up on the mountain. And Creator, thank you for these beautiful people and their intent to go up there for the rest of us. And blow it into the bundle. And then I look around for my twine. It's always good to have some unexpected humor. Situation.
Is it on your lap?
On the wing?
It's on the wing, is... Kedar.
It's on the wing.
Oh, I knew that. It's right away we get those teachings of, we say that the only adversary of the spiritual warrior is self-importance, and losing your twine is a good way to avoid self-importance. You don't even laugh at yourself. So you tie it on here, like so. And then the if I were making prayer ties myself for going up on the mountain, I would have a ball of twine that would be at the end of this. And so I would make one, and then I would go down the twine about, you know, 6 or 7 inches, and I would make another one. And I would tie it on there, blow the prayer in. I would go down the twine, and I would make another one, and another one. So when you're working off a ball of twine, let's say, this can get quite long and filled with prayers over time. This is a ceremony that I suggest starting once you plant your intent to do the ceremony, as you begin making your prayers. And it's meant to become like a daily touchstone. So you make 7 prayers a day. Whether it's if the morning is your quiet time, or the evening, whenever that time of day is where you can sit down and just make 7 a day. And that way each day you touch the ceremony and are touched by the ceremony as you prepare. And then as I said earlier, as we get close to the time of going up on the mountain to go to your loved ones, your community, solicit from them the things that they are carrying on their heart that you can make a prayer about and carry it up on the mountain for them. You want them to know that you'll be doing that. Those you might want to write down when they tell you, so that later when you're making your prayers, you can hold it, that specific intent and words in your mind, and blow it into the prayer. So that's the making of prayer ties. This idea that we go up on the mountain not simply for ourselves, but for our community. The other is this concept of preparing for quest. Is this idea that the quest, the walkabout, the initiatory journey, all of the various names that's been given to this particular ceremony around the world throughout history, of going into the wild to fast, to pray, to seek vision, is considered into the category of what we call death and rebirth ceremonies. So in that regard, another part of the preparation in that way is, if you think about this quest that you're approaching as this ceremonial death, we say, then how do you choose to live between now and then? Which means, are there people you need to speak with to offer amends or forgiveness to yourself, or so you don't carry these unresolved stories up on the mountain? So again, you approach it as if you are approaching your own death, and therefore the teaching around making death your ally is, how then do I choose to live my life between now and then? And so then I approach it with, you know, are there people I need to check in with, to speak to, living or non-living, to hear or to say some things that need to be said or listened to before I go up on the mountain. So you don't just want to carry all that karmic luggage with you up on the mountain and then bring it back down so you can do it all over again. So as much as possible, where they say, where it does no harm to do it in the physical, and if there's some question or challenge of doing it physically, you can do it ceremonially, where you speak those words without the person's physical presence. But important to do that, that way of approaching the ceremony in that way. Like I say, we think of life beginning with birth, at least in this lifetime, and ending with death in this lifetime. We say the initiatory passage runs opposite the flow of life, and that it begins with death and ends with birth. It goes the opposite way. And so to prepare for the ceremony is to prepare as if you were dying. And therefore, again, how then do I live if this is where I'm headed? So it really puts things in perspective and eliminates a lot of needless dramas and things that might otherwise go on when we live with death as our ally. So that's the broader approach. Some people will have their will made. Some people will finalize certain decisions that they don't want hanging out there on the mountain with them. If there are things you are clear about, if there are actions in your life you are clear about, then it may be time to take those actions before going to the mountain. So that's the broader context of the walk towards the mountain, as some of you have spoken about. How do you walk towards the mountain? As you walk as if you were walking towards your own death, with that kind of clarity and that kind of, hopefully that kind of compassion and love. And so the making of prayer ties is one of the ceremonies of preparation that I recommend. That begins right away. The other one that typically is done about a month beforehand is a one-day medicine walk. And by that I mean a one day from sunrise to sunset where you go into a natural area, somewhere in nature, let somebody know where you're going, you know, and when you'll be back. And all that you take with you is your water and a journal. So you have an encapsulated experience of fasting, at least during the daytime, in nature, with none of the distractions of nature. And if you can do it without a watch, that can be good as well. The way that you begin that journey is if you're going into a place in nature that you know, when you get to the trailhead, whatever that trailhead is, maybe a parking lot, maybe actual trailhead, before you begin your walk, to begin around sunrise and mark your entrance into the walk in some ceremonial way. It could be simply scratching a line in the dirt and saying a prayer and asking for insight and guidance. And then once you step across that line into your walk, you're walking in that realm. You've opened the space or opened the portal, and the attention you give to it is very different than your everyday life. You may walk with questions like, what is it that's calling me to this quest? What is it that I wish to mark with this ceremony? Am I marking some period of severance in my life? Am I marking some betwixt and between time or some incorporation time? And the details of that. So you begin to walk with those kind of questions. And there are other questions that you have in the material that you receive from me to begin to think about, you know, who are my teachers? Who are my elders? Who are my guides? What is my passion in life? What is the medicine I carry? What am I putting down? Just lots of questions that begin to walk with you in this medicine walk. I always like to say, if you're going into a place you know very well, just let your intuitive sense take you wherever it takes you, because you won't get lost. If you're not going into a place you know well, then either a loop trail or an in-and-out trail is a safe way. And since you have your journal, you know, really take time to deepen that relationship. And the other thing about a medicine walk, when I say medicine walk, it doesn't mean you're walking all day. It means that you're walking with an intent of open awareness to the questions you carry. And you may find yourself by a stream and you spend half a day there. Or you may find yourself sitting under a large tree, oak or maple, and you spend a day there. Or you find yourself walking much of the day. So it's not, to say medicine walk, I don't mean necessarily that you're walking the whole time. Everything that comes to you is important. You've set an intention, you've set a prayer, you've asked for guidance. So whatever encounters you have, even of the humankind, take notice. What's being offered here? Or what's being asked of me? A lot of times, because of our human tendencies to think more egocentrically, we're always going into nature thinking, what does it have for me? It may want something from you. It may say, see how dirty this river is, would you help clean it up? So to begin to understand in your medicine walk, there often is that reciprocity of relationship. It's not just what is offered to us, but also what may be needed from us. So the medicine walk, again, is it's a very usual ceremony of preparation, and I know that most guides work with that one. And it's done about a month out. The third ceremony of preparation has less of a time frame like the first two, like the prayer ties begin as soon as you can, the medicine walk about a month before you arrive. The other one is to intuitively do this one in a timing that feels right for you. And I call this one the ancestor fire ritual. The intent of this one is that when doing this ceremony, you've made all the preparations, all the physical plain stuff. You've signed papers, you made paid deposits, you've made arrangements for travel. You've done all these things on the physical plane to say, I'm in. With ceremony, it would be negligent to not go to your ancestors and say, this is what I'm doing. Will you walk with me? Will you guide me? So this comes from now. We turn our attention to that realm of our ancestors to bring them on board with our intent and with our prayers. And I've spoken to many of you before, when you're working with ancestors or calling on your ancestors, that you want to call on the ones that I call well in spirit, where I have a phrase, those that lived well and died well, and those that are well in spirit at this time in my lineage. And that may be way, way, way back. It doesn't mean, you know, Uncle Joe, that may have been an abusive alcoholic, and you think, why would I want to call, you know, my ancestors? I didn't really like them, some of them, when they were here. So there's a delineation that when you're calling in help from your own lineage, that you call in the ones that are well. So the invocation is, or the setup for this ritual, the things you need for the ritual, is a stone about this size, a bucket of water, a couple gallon bucket of water, a ladle for the bucket of water, to be able to build a fire and heat this one stone in a fire for at least 2 to 3 hours. So you're going to build a fire on top of this stone, and you're going to have enough wood to keep feeding the fire so the stone gets red hot in a period of time. The other thing that you'll need for this ritual is something to reach into the fire when it's time and slide the stone out, so like a pitchfork or a shovel. I think pitchforks are actually better because they tend not to pick up a lot of the burning coal, they just pull the stone out. And then something to sweep the stone off. Could be a branch from a conifer tree, like cedar or juniper, but something to sweep the ash off the stone once you pull it out in front of you. The other thing you'll need is an essential oil that goes into the water. And you think, well, what essential oil? So here's the thing behind this. You intuit, or you find out, what would be an essential oil from a plant or a tree essence that would have come from the lands of my ancestors? And for many of you, you have different lineages and they come from different places. Just trust your intuition about what comes to you. Well, I know that they come from this land or that land. And what plants or trees might have been part of their medicine or part of what they used in their meals and their food. And so you get that. So it's a very intuitive process of beginning to connect to your lineage, to the lands of your lineage. As I say, a generous amount of oil drops will go in the water at the beginning of the ritual. And then the other thing to bring to the ritual before I describe the choreography of the ritual is to bring an offering. In ceremony and ritual, we want to shift our consciousness from that of what might be called looking at things as a commodity and more through reciprocity. So when we're going to fire or we're going to say prayer, what is our offering? In this case with ancestors, what would have been something your ancestors would have eaten? Or some libation they may have drank that you know is like significant to a lineage. In my Irish, one of my Irish branches of lineage, we'd say I might bring some Irish brown bread. Or for some of those close-in ancestors that are well in spirit, definitely would bring some chocolate or some Irish whiskey. But things that I would make as an offering of reciprocity to the fire. And so you've got the setup. You do this as it's in that liminal space between day and night. So as the sun's going down, this is a ritual you do by yourself. And it begins with setting your fire, having all the things that I mentioned with you. Once you light the fire, and then begin to speak your invocation. Because this ceremony is not simply a test of will or endurance, it is meant to be an experience that you have to call on something greater than yourself in order to make the passage. Ancestors, your relationship to the sacred, and what other pathway of understanding that you follow. So this invocation calls specifically to those we could say generally helping spirits, but in particular your ancestors, the well ancestors of your lineage. Once you've spoken the invocation, meaning to call upon, you're also saying, why are you calling on them? And like they're showing up. And so the way that I think about it is you're calling on them to assist you in remembering the agreements you made with them before coming here about what gifts of healing, medicine, and offering you were bringing to this world through those lines of lineage. And to help you remember that, to connect deeply to them. So when to go up on the mountain is to remember more deeply who you are and the medicine you carry. So this invocation, this prayer for that intent, you know, ancestors, grandmothers, grandfathers, you know, I humbly come before you. Please walk with me. Help me remember what I came here to offer. Guide me on this path toward the mountain and into the ceremony. So you speak the invocation, the fire is burning now. Imagine, and maybe you do make a little seat across the fire from you. Imagine you now have a couple of an ancient grandmother, an ancient grandfather that have energetically shown up at the fire. And imagine them saying to you across this fire, you know, granddaughter, grandson, what brings you to this fire? And the truth of the question is that your entire life brings you to the fire. Your entire life brings you to this one moment. So the response is, you know, grandmother, grandfather, my life brings me here, and here's my life. And you share your life story while that stone is cooking. It's going to be cooking a couple of hours, and so you tell your story. You know, your difficulties, your challenges, your hopes and dreams, your joys, your all of it. I always like to say, if all you can do is weep, they actually understand that better than words. So don't worry about having appropriate language or clever syntax to communicate. Fumbling and stumbling and tears are actually a clearer message when we're communicating with the sacred than having some kind of exact wording of that sounds good to our own ears, or as if somebody else were listening, that would be impressed. So you just speak what's in your heart. And then once that story is shared, you listen and you watch. You study the fire. Maybe there are messages that are beginning to come through the fire. But you're watching and studying the fire and feeding the fire. Now we say ritually, this stone person, this mineral piece, the way that we understand this piece in ritual is that the stone people are the record keepers, the record holders, or we could say the transponders and transceivers of information and communication. And the fire, or I'd say the particular face of fire that you're working with in this ritual, is that of opening a door. So when you place this communication device, as it were, to be cooked in a doorway that you have now opened with prayer to connect and communicate with your ancestors, the conversation begins. And so this stone, this transponder, is sending and receiving information. And so now after you've spoken, you're sitting in the quiet watching the fire and listening with the ears of your heart. And at some point you'll feel the nudge that it's time to take the stone out. And then when it's time to take the stone out of the fire, you reach in with the pitchfork and you slide it out in front of you. And you sweep the ash off of it. And then with the bucket of water and the ladle and the oil that you've put in the water, you begin to ladle that water and you pour it on the stone. And as the steam rises off this stone in front of you, you fan the steam into your lungs. You breathe it in. So it's pouring the water, steam rising. So what you're doing is you're ingesting their response back to you. Ritually, you're taking in that which they are now releasing from this communication device that's coming to you in the form of this plant or tree medicine essence that is connected with the lands of your ancestors. You're drawing it in within you. And this is not about hearing, understanding, getting any cognitive download of information. That's not important. It's just that the act of intent and prayer and ingesting what is coming back to you. Good night on this night to pay attention to your dreams. Once all that feels complete and the ritual feels done, if you're familiar with invocations and ritual, this is not one of those situations where you now turn around and release that which you've called in, because they're going to stay with you. So that the space has been opened. Or we say that the discourse of communication with your ancestral helping spirits has been initiated. It's not closed down. So the stone comes with you. It comes with you to quest. And maybe until you arrive at quest, it might sit beside your bed. Or if you have an ancestor altar, it might sit there until you come here. But you bring that with you to the quest, like prayer ties. And then both the prayer ties and the stone that's been cooked in the fire has come with you. And the other thing about prayer ties, you want to start wrapping those prayers around the stick, because they're going to get long and you don't want them to get tangled up. So you start to wrap them around the stick. So when you go out on the during your 4 days and four nights into the wild, you take that stone and you take those prayers with you. And when you build that circle around you of purpose, that place that is the tomb and the womb of your ceremonial death and rebirth, you will find the place in that circle where that communication device with your ancestors will sit. And those prayers that have become quite long now, well, they'll go around you in that circle. And so you're questing in the middle of those prayers with that stone in your circle. So that's the destination for those two pieces. So the the three ceremonies of preparation again are the making of prayer ties, the ancestor fire ritual, and the medicine walk. And all that being said, I look forward to seeing you around the fire here very soon.